Invitata noastră de astăzi a avut o copilărie aparte. Tatăl ei a fost un evanghelist faimos, autor al unui bestseller, cunoscut și în România sub titlul Crucea și Pumnalul, film pe care l-ați putut vedea și la Credo TV, lectura cărții la Radio Vocea Evangheliei. Astfel că am chemat-o pe Debbie Wilkerson-Ionca să ne povestească despre acest personaj faimos din postura privilegiată de fiică a sa și despre urmările pe care inevitabil le are traiul cu un asemenea om deosebit. So, Debbie Wilkerson-Ionca, when did you discover that your father was a bit special, was not a father like other fathers? Because you were very little when he was involved in those incredible stories in New York with the gangs.
Yes. Well, I always thought that he was just a normal father, of course.
Yeah.
But I knew that he traveled a lot. And sometimes I had a friend, a little friend, she said, "Is your father famous?"
So that's what, yeah. How you found out?
Yeah, is he famous?
And what did
father?
You say?
Because
no.
Because he preached. And, no, he's just my daddy. But I realized that as God started to call him to go to New York City, and then I remember him reading about the gangs in New York, and he wanted to go help them, and he was in the newspaper. And so I thought, he must be a little bit famous, that, you know, and more people are knowing about him. But New York City was so far away from where my little world was.
That so. You didn't worry too much about it.
No, I was just thankful. I was just wanting to come home. I was glad when he came home.
And did he bring you anything when he came home?
Well, actually, one night, it was pretty funny. My sister and I were sleeping. We were probably about 6 or 7 years old. And in the middle of the night, he came home, and because he would come home late sometimes, and we thought he brought us a monkey, but it was a little black doggy. He brought a real dog home, and so we were so excited and so happy, and my mother said, "Oh no," and we said, "Oh, it's a monkey." And he said, "No, it's a little doggy." Little black doggy.
Was it so ugly, or why did you?
No, it was a poodle. It was. But it meant so much to us when he came home, and just to be with our daddy, and to have the doggy too.
A big happy family.
Yes, yes.
Uh-huh. So it was only you and your sister when he was very, very active in New York.
Yes.
Brothers.
We had two brothers, though. Yes.
Were
later
they
on, a little bit later.
In this, a little bit later.
Yes. We had two younger brothers, but I was the oldest, and I felt like I was kind of older. Yeah, take care of everybody. And, or my brothers and sisters.
And when you were a bit older, as a teenager. Did your feelings change about the whole situation, knowing that your father has such a special ministry?
Well, sometimes we went with him. As I got older, my sister and I went to New York with him when I was a teenager. And that I loved that. We went on a rooftop one time of a building, and that's where some gangs had been before. And I thought that was wonderful to be... There was gangs here in New York, and he was always very careful with us, and protective. But when he left, it was hard on my mom, and I'm sure for raising us four children. But for me, I knew he was doing a wonderful work, but I missed him very much. And that was a time where I began to feel like maybe someday I'll do something for God. You know, I'll go somewhere and help people.
Did you have this, I don't know, maybe a sort of frustration that you need to raise to your father's expectations or other people's expectations because you were his daughter?
Yeah, I did feel that way sometimes. I like to tell everybody that, but I'll tell you. No, I at times I felt like I had to be on performing or showcase. My mom liked to dress us all up, of course. You know, every mother did that. But people thought that we were so perfect.
Ah, just the way you were?
Yeah, because they only saw the outside.
Ah, people saw you as perfect. People from outside?
Yeah, yes. And they wanted to, because of my father being famous, they wanted to, you know, oh, hello, you know, and
talk to you.
Yeah, maybe they would be a little bit like David Wilkerson if they, you know, touched us or something. But I don't think that most people were like that. Most people were very kind and very loving. We went to their homes when we traveled when we were younger. My father preached, and we would stay with them, and they were very, very loving.
But did your father have expectations from you to do great things like he did?
Oh, no. No. He just wanted us to be us, just to be who God made us to be. We all had different gifts and different interests. And sometimes we had a little bit rebellion and we didn't want to be like that, you know.
Ah, okay, good.
Well, I'll never be a preacher. I'll never be a preacher's wife.
And are you now a preacher's
now,
wife?
Well, we're in the ministry, but not in a church. I share sometimes with my friends that are preacher's wives, I could never be a preacher's wife. You know, expectations, and you have to be smiling all the time, and I'm like, oh, I'm tired. But what a blessing it is to be in the ministry and to be a preacher's wife, because you see the need, and they love you. They want help, and you're there because you have been given so much in your life, and you want to give back. And so we love it. We have a ministry for inner city kids in the United States, in Texas.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and you know that, so we like that.
Mm-hmm. But staying just a bit more to your father's ministry, he got to write a book after a while when the ministry was developing. How did you feel when a book came out, that book? The book got so much success, was so successful.
Yes. Uh-huh. How did I feel about the book?
Were you nervous before you knew the book would be a success?
No, I don't think I was so nervous about it. No, I was just excited that my father wrote a book, and we were just like, you know, like regular kids that would just be like their father did something special, and wow, daddy wrote a book. And
but how old?
You know, when he came home, he didn't talk about that very much, you know, his mm-hmm. books and preaching, and it was just, what are we going to do today, you know? So, but I understood what was going on, and my sister did too. And we were, the question is more about how did I feel about him writing a book,
mm-hmm.
and if it was going to make him more famous.
Or how would people react to it?
Love him or not love him? True. Yeah, that's true. I remember listening to conversations with my mom and dad with other people. Mm-hmm. Preachers, and I remember my father asking their opinions. What do you think the reaction is going to be with the church world? Do you think that they're going to think I'm radical? And I think they did. I think they thought he was radical. But it's okay, because he had to be. You know, that's what God called him to do.
And that was the way he was all the time. I mean, mm-hmm. from such a mission.
Mm-hmm.
And as I've seen and read, he was radical.
Yes, yes.
Almost crazy to go there and start what?
True.
He didn't even know very clearly what was starting there.
That's
in
very
New York
true.
At that time.
Mm-hmm. Yes, because he was a skinny country preacher. They used to say that about him.
Yeah, that was another characteristic as we've seen it. Mm-hmm. He didn't know exactly what was going to happen, but he kept going on.
Mm-hmm.
And he needed specific things or specific amounts of money sometimes.
Yes.
And he got specific amounts of time, of money,
yeah,
and
right.
things when he asked.
True.
How? Mm-hmm. What is the recipe for getting precisely what you need when mm-hmm. you ask something for God,
true.
As he gets God?
Yeah, that's true. Good question. I know that God, you know, opened doors, yet I wonder how the practical part of it was. What did he do to actually start this work? They needed buildings, they needed funds to feed the people that came in off the streets and so forth. But I remember he would pray, they would pray, and the next day there would be a check in the mail. But also, God brought men that love God that were blessed with funds and money. There was a place in New York City called Tiffany's. It was a very expensive jewelry store. Have you heard of that?
Yes.
And the man that owns it is a Christian, and he helped start Teen Challenge, and he helped start. There's a farm that he started for men in Pennsylvania, and he funded that, and they named certain buildings after him. And
so there are some
father.
Jewelries in these Excuse missions.
Excuse me?
There are some jewelries in these missions.
Yeah. So maybe that's why we named our little girl Tiffany.
Oh, yes. It all connects. Incredible. But so people came, the right people at the right time, mm-hmm. and only because he prayed, nothing
also
else.
True, yes. Also, people from churches all over began to hear about what my father was doing. He would go and speak at the churches, and they would take up an offering for him.
Did it happen, I don't know, once or twice or several times that he would not get an open door? Be refused.
Where it was going to come from, yeah. Sometimes they wondered where where the money would come from.
Yeah, and was he refused? Yeah. Did it happen that he should go somewhere and to someone and not be helped,
help? I think I remember him saying there was some churches that were against what he was doing, that uh-huh. they thought he should stay where he was, maybe in the church back in Pennsylvania.
Why should he stay? Yeah.
Oh,
what was their argument?
Probably they thought that he didn't think he could do it. He would go to New York City, and he was just kind of crazy. Mm. And why should they give their money to something that was going to be crazy? There wasn't very many like that. Maybe one or two that thought that way. Isn't there always some places that are like that? And why should you stop what you want to do, you know, what God calls you to do, because of someone's voices? If you listen to the voices, their voices, you won't accomplish what God wants you to accomplish. And he knew that in his heart. I'm going to New York, I'm going to New York City, and I'm going to start this work for God. You know.
Did he ever explain to you how this calling was made explicit to him?
Yes, because sometimes we said, where are you going again? Where are you going again now, Daddy? He explained it to us. Yes, I have to go to New York City, we're going to start this work. And we were going to move there to New York and live there.
So and we didn't have you to ask leave. Why?
Yeah, well, sure, yeah, because we were just normal kids. We didn't want to leave our friends and my grandmother and grandfather, and we lived with them, and so that was hard.
But what was his explanation to you as children? What did he say? Why?
He said, you know how well God speaks to you, Debbie, or if you're doing something that he wants you to do, something like maybe help somebody in church, and he wants you to go to that younger little girl and say, Jesus loves you. And he said that there's many people that don't know Jesus, and we're going to go tell them about Jesus. Because I was still young, and maybe I didn't understand the full scope of what he wanted to do. Mm-hmm. I want to, you know, start buildings. I want to start this. Maybe I wouldn't have understood that. So he kept it simple for us.
And when you got older, as a teenager maybe, okay. and understood more things, weren't you scared of those people and those addictions and that environment?
Well, he didn't bring us, you know, into the environments that were...
But you knew where
we
he
knew
was.
That he was going there.
Yeah. Yes.
Well, you know, you heard about the movie and the book, of course. We were talking about the book. After we started reading the book, then we found out more that what he did.
Ah, so you found out more from the book.
He went to, you know, where they were had knives and
and bad looks.
We'd be okay. but he would tell us the stories about places that he went to or where he was going to, and we weren't afraid. I don't think we were afraid about and worried about it.
Rather,
I think my brothers wanted to you know, be that like that. I wanted to go there with him, and but he said, no, you can't go, you know, stay with mama. And but I'm sure there were times where we, at night when we would go to sleep, that we'd be a little bit afraid that where are we going, you know, is it going to be dangerous, you know, because that's, isn't that normal for every child to think about
what the
future holds?
Was he scared?
I don't know that. He didn't seem like it. I didn't. Oh.
Or maybe he kept that away from you,
so.
Because you were the children.
I think he was afraid. I think he had that courage and bravery from God, the Lord, from God. He knew he couldn't do that on his own. He probably said, God, if I'm going to go into this place, and here's this, you know, Nikki Cruz, this guy that's going to come, and he's bleeding, and he's, you know, says, I hate you, stay away from me. God, I need you now, you know, I need your courage, strength right now, in this moment. Maybe when he got home, he thought, phew, where did that come from?
Wow, what was that? And he was there in the middle of it.
Yeah, because he knew he couldn't do that on his own.
And was there a time when you realized that people outside your family see your father in a, from a certain perspective, but you as his daughter see him differently because it's he's your father?
Are you speaking about right now, like when he was alive, that was he?
Yeah.
How I felt about him,
I mean,
at this age.
You must have known something else about him, something that people outside couldn't know.
Oh, I see.
Can you tell us? Can you tell us such things that you saw in him, but people outside couldn't because they were not so close?
Right. Most of the time when I was with my father, he was so concerned about me, how I felt, and looked at me and said, Debbie, what are you going through? What do you need? How are you with the Lord? You know, are you reading the Word? And sometimes I would say, yeah. When I was younger, yeah, I'm reading the Word. But I've always felt like, wow, he loves me so much. I don't feel neglected. I don't feel like he's putting his attention on everybody else because there were so many people around him. I felt like he just is, you know, centering in on me, you know, and blocking the world out and wondering how Debbie is, and then Bonnie, my sister, you know, and everybody else in my family. But I needed him so much when I was hurting and going through things. I felt like he would hear something from God, and he could say something to me like, Debbie, I really see that the Lord wants to do this in your life, and then let's just go out to eat, you know? Let's go shopping. Or he was just a, you know, everyday type of man that wanted to spend time with me and his children. And then when we were walking in the mall, he would always have his arm around me, and he'd say, these are my beautiful girls, my beautiful wife and my beautiful girls. And we just felt so proud. It was our handsome daddy.
Yeah, because it was.
Well, we thought he was handsome, you know, and everybody said that.
And you really believed
that.
Yeah,
but sometimes when I was around other people, I would just be, can everybody just go away a little bit and I could be with my daddy? Yeah. He's tired. He needs to rest. And preachers are like that. They need to have some quiet time.
In my eyes, he's a bit more than a preacher. He was such a complex character because he not only preached, spoke words, but he had a lot of actions. Mm-hmm. He did a lot of things, not only preach, not only speak, more than words.
That's true.
Danger and risk and on his own sometimes, because rightly so many people thought he was a bit crazy to get into that mission. So when so many people look at you that way, maybe you get a bit lonely because you're on your own with God, but not everybody understands that from the outside.
Well, years later though, you know, the more that he became established and preached, and he became to have confidence in the Lord, and we became to have more confidence too, that when we went to the meetings or we went to church, we felt strong in the Lord also. So there wasn't that, loneliness. We became more excited about it. Wow, what's God going to do? And we just wanted more of Jesus, more of what people were being touched, people were being changed in their lives. We began to see what, it wasn't about my father anymore. It was about, this is Jesus. It had to be him. Yeah.
Oh, so that's a new level.
I think so. I hope so, because I don't want to stay, you know.
In the shadow of your father.
Yeah, I think so. He knew that his time on earth was short. We knew that there would be a time where he wouldn't be there, and he was preparing us. He said, you know, Debbie, I'm not always going to be here. You need to stand strong in the Lord. There's going to be times where you're going to suffer, go through rough times, and you have to look to Jesus. So, that's good.
I was curious to know what kind of legacy has he left you? How is your faith, I don't know, unique?
Yeah.
Because he was your father.
Okay. Well, sometimes it's not real strong. You know, I feel like, I'm just not going to make this. I'm not going to make it. The race, the journey is long. Without Dad, I want him to be back here. But the legacy comes from not because of who he was, but because of what Christ did in his life. So not only he, but my mother instilled in us something special, because we knew that we were blessed to have a mom and dad that loved God with all their hearts and loved the people, God's people. He was like a shepherd, you know, that leads his sheep. And so I feel like there must be something else that I can carry on, that I can do to show, not just show people of who I am, but say, oh, you remember my father? He said this, he did this. And they said, oh, yes, we remember the sermons that he preached. He preached about that the world was going to, things were going to happen in the world. Because there was another book called Set the Trumpet to Thy Mouth, and he spoke about the prophecy of the Word of God that was come to pass, that the world, Jesus was coming soon, and the wars would be coming. And so we all knew that too, and there was a sense of urgency in our hearts. So I think that's the legacy, is Jesus coming in, living through us. And
so being very much alive and not waste energy and time.
There you go. That's it.
And he has written more than two books. He wrote more than two books.
Yes. Right. He wrote quite a few books.
Can you give us another title that you like in a special way?
Let's see. Set the Trumpet to Thy Mouth is a very good book. America's Last Call. And then there's a book called Rebel's Bible. And he didn't really like that book very much, but it was one of my favorite books.
Why didn't he like it?
It was very radical. He talked about the hippie movement in New York City in the back in the days when the drugs were back on the streets, and everybody had long hair and all that.
And flowers wrote, in it.
Excuse me?
And flowers in the hair.
Flowers in their hair, yeah, that's true, peace. And yeah, and there was a movement back then, the Jesus movement too, and he wrote poetry about that. And it was so good, because I love poetry also. And so I said, Daddy, that was my favorite book. And he said, no, it's just a little bit not what I thought he would write when he got older. He wrote it when he was younger. But that's one of my favorite books too. And The Cross and Switchblade also.
And some book of where he collected testimonies of people who got saved.
Yes, there's a book called 12 Angels from Hell. That's a great book. It talked about the ones, gang members that were on the streets, and they got saved. And so it was the 12 Angels from Hell. And that was one of my favorite books too. And there's another one called Purple Violet Squish. And that was about drugs, those that were on drugs that got saved and healed from drugs. But Purple Violet Squish was like when you're on LSD or drugs, that you just start to see all these hazy things in your mind, purple and, mm-hmm. you know, that they're so stoned and drugged, and how God just, you know, saved them. And I got to see some of that too, some of these kids that were on drugs, and that was wonderful to see how God saved them and rescued them. And his testimonies were about that.
Because his legacy to you was not only something deep inside your heart, but also in charitable missions that you're involved in.
Yes, yes. He's always had a heart for missions and when I was younger also.
And you got involved in those too.
Yes. All my brothers and sisters are involved in the missions. And we feel like that's an honor that God would allow us to do that. Like, mm-hmm. why would you call me, you know? We still think that, even if my father is famous, I still think, why call me? I'm not anybody special. But we all are, you know, and we love to go overseas, and then our ministry helps support other ministries.
Mm-hmm. So, because your father had such good titles for his books, how would you entitle, I don't know, in a very few words, the film of his life, as you knew him, as people saw him, what title would you give to his life? I know you haven't thought about it, but just asking.
No, that's okay. Sometimes I think about that. Yeah, there is a book that's coming out about my father's life. My brother Gary is writing a book. But mm-hmm. so far as thinking about just the whole view of his life, I think it would be just come to Jesus.
Just come to Jesus.
Yeah, because that wouldn't focus on him or my family. It would be like, hurry up and come to Jesus. But also just that he is good, God is good, and that, you know, the whole life of my father was wrapped up in the Word of God. The Bible, you know, in his Bible, it was all marked, and he had underlined, and my sister has his Bible, and, so I remember that, and the Bible was so precious to him, so it would just be that, you know, that studying the Word of God, how important that was, and...
Wait for the miracles.
Excuse me?
And wait for the miracles.
Yes, wait for the miracles. That's a good title, is Come to Jesus and See the Miracles. Mm-hmm.